worship here at St. Marcus Lutheran Church. We are back. We're back in worship. I've got to say that as a pastor, it is great for me to actually see your faces in the pews rather than imagine your faces in the pews. So I'm very thankful for that, and I hope that you're thankful too to come back together. But we're also very thankful for our online audience. And we understand that right now there could be 4, 5, 6 times as many people as are here right now who are worshiping with us. And that is just an incredible blessing that together we get to worship in spirit and truth. And today we're doing it under the theme of walking in the Word. It's the second Sunday of Pentecost. Walking in the Word is our theme. Now, you've all heard that expression, you can't just talk the talk, you have to walk the walk. Our Lord God doesn't only speak to us through bumper stickers like that, but a lot of His, what He has to say to us today in His Holy Word really fits in to that description of how He wants to bless us, not by just giving us a word to hear, but a word to do, to live, to feel, to walk in. So think about that today as we worship the Lord. The order of service will be printed out for you on the screens, and we are ready to go with our first hymn, Beautiful Savior. God bless your worship today.
Please stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Dear friends, let us approach God with a true heart and confess our sins, asking Him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to forgive us. Lord of life, I confess that I am by nature dead in sin, for faithless worrying and selfish pride, for sins of habit and sins of choice, for the evil I have done and the good I have failed to do. You should cast me away from your presence forever. O Lord, I am sorry for my sins. Forgive me for Jesus' sake. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. In His great mercy, God made us alive in Christ, even when we were dead in our sins. Hear the word of Christ through His called servant. I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Let us pray. O Lord God, you have promised to all who trust and believe in you that you will work out all things for our good. Remember your promise, Lord, when we come to you in our time of need, and help us to remember the many times that you have turned disaster into blessing for us. We will call upon you in the day of trouble. You will deliver us, and we will glorify you. Hear us now, for we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated.
In the garden with him.
Our scripture lesson today is taken from Deuteronomy chapter 11. Long ago, through his servant Moses, who spoke these words just before the Israelites entered the promised land, God impressed upon his people the extreme importance of walking in his word. We read, "Fix these words of mine in your hearts and minds. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Teach them to your children, talking about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates, so that your days and the days of your children may be many in the land the Lord swore to give your ancestors, as many as the days that the heavens are above the earth. See, I am setting before you today a blessing and a curse. The blessing, if you obey the commands of the Lord your God that I am giving you today. The curse, if you disobey the commands of the Lord your God and turn from the way that I command you today by following other gods which you have not known." This is the word of the Lord. We continue now with the hymn of the day, "My Hope is Built on Nothing Less." The kingdom of this world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. Amen. God's word for our consideration in this message is taken from Matthew chapter 7, beginning with verse 21, where Jesus says, "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, 'Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name, and in your name drive out demons, and in your name perform many miracles?' Then I will tell them plainly, 'I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoers.' Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house. Yet it did not fall, because it had its foundation on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like a foolish man who built his house on sand. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell with a great crash." When Jesus had finished saying these things, the crowds were amazed at his teaching, because he taught as one who had authority and not as their teachers of the law. This is the word of the Lord. For those of us who are over the age of, 40, the name Lee Iacocca might ring a bell. Not sure if I have that age right, 40. But if you're under 40, or if you're not really familiar with Lee Iacocca, but you have seen the movie Ford versus Ferrari, maybe you saw that Lee Iacocca was featured in that film just a little bit as an up-and-coming executive in Ford Motor Car Company in the Ford Motor Corporation in the 1960s. And his star rose quickly because he was sort of at the forefront of many successful projects with Ford, including the development of the Ford Mustang, which of course was wildly popular. But you know, Mr. Iacocca did not become a recognizable figure to the public until the 1980s, when he left Ford and he took on a position at the floundering Chrysler Corporation. And he was most instrumental in kind of getting Chrysler back to respectability at the time. And now, most auto executives are not going to be known to the public. Like, they would not be recognized out in public. But Mr. Iacocca was, and here's why. He was in all their commercials. All of the Chrysler commercials in the 1980s, and they were pretty good commercials, featured Lee Iacocca. So one day, this man found himself in an elevator with Lee Iacocca, and he recognized him, and he overcame his initial shyness, and he got up the gumption to ask, "You're Lee Iacocca, aren't you?" And Mr. Iacocca acknowledged that he was. And this man then went on to say, "I just have to tell you, Mr. Iacocca, how much I really like your commercials." To which Iacocca said, "Sir, I couldn't care less what you think of my commercials. What I want to know is, what kind of car do you drive? You see, there's always a bottom line. And in businesses, whether they be big or small, that bottom line is always going to involve dollars and cents. It's going to involve revenues being more than disbursements. What would you answer somebody who asked you, what's the bottom line of life? And I think instinctively we get from that question that that person is not asking about dollars and cents. They're not asking about whether one side of the ledger is larger than the other. No, what they're asking about is, what's the most important thing? What is the thing that can support you when everything else fails? What's the most precious possession that you can possibly have in this life? That's the bottom line. And what is it? Well, we hope we would answer what the Word of God answers, and that's Jesus. Knowing Jesus Christ in faith, trusting Him for your soul's salvation, placing your sins on Him and receiving from Him His righteousness, that's the bottom line. But I think Jesus' words to us today that we heard just a moment ago and that we'll be going over, I think they're going to test our answer just a little bit. Because, you know, it is one thing to say that Christ is our bottom line, but He is much more interested in what actually is the bottom line of our life, what we are building our hopes, our wants, our desires on. And so His question for us today is, what kind of life are you building? And the message that He gives us today to help us answer that question, what kind of life we are building, presents us with two distinct choices. Two bottom lines that have two very different results. The sand of self will let you down. The rock of Christ will hold you up forever. Now, these words to us today from Jesus are the concluding words of what is often called the Sermon on the Mount, so named because of its mountainside setting in Galilee. And one thing that I believe Christians really have to recognize whenever they're in the Sermon on the Mount in their Bible, which, by the way, would be Matthew 5, 6, and 7. When you're in there, remember this. Jesus was talking to disciples of His. People who had put their trust in Him for their soul's salvation. So you see, this is not a message about how to become a disciple. But it is a message about what a disciple looks like, what a disciple thinks about, how a disciple lives. And not just the outward actions, but as I mentioned, the thoughts and the inner attitudes of the heart. And yet, those thoughts and inner attitudes and actions are never presented by our Lord Jesus as like steps on a road or rungs on a ladder that we gotta climb in order to make ourselves right with God. He doesn't do that. He presents all of these attitudes and actions in the Sermon on the Mount as the life responses of somebody who knows that he or she has been saved by Jesus Christ. And to make that point one last time, this is what he says at the end of his message. He says, "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter the kingdom of heaven. Many will say to me on that day, 'Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name, and in your name drive out demons, and in your name perform many miracles?' Then I will tell them plainly, 'I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoers.'" Now, I don't know how shocking that was to you, but it's shocking to me. Because the people that Jesus is describing in those verses are like the super saints, right? I mean, they are the ones that to all of the world outwardly, right, they have Christian written all over them. And they have even done great things in the name of Christ. And yet, Jesus says, on the last day, he will have nothing to do with them. And he even calls them evildoers. Why? Well, for all of their outward religiosity, there was nothing on the inside. There was no trust in Jesus Christ as the one and only Savior from sin on the inside. In other words, they had built their life on the sand of self, trusting in themselves, and that's always going to let you down for eternity. And it reminds me of what Jesus once said to a person who asked him this question in John chapter 6. "What must I do to do the works God requires?" Which, of course, is another way of asking, what must I do to save myself, to get myself right with God so that he's going to accept me? And then this is what Jesus responded to that question. "The work of God is this." And I bet everybody was waiting for the, okay, here it comes. Here comes the checklist of things that you got to check off in your life so that you're good enough to be with God one day. But this is what Jesus said. "The work of God is this, to believe in the one he has sent." So you see what Jesus did there. Being right with God, going to heaven when we die. It's not about what we do. It's about what he has done, what Jesus has done, and putting our trust in that. The picture that Jesus uses in the Sermon on the Mount today reminds me of some of these just terribly expensive homes that you might see like on HGTV or one of those other shows about beautiful, expensive homes. And let's say it's somewhere in California, Laguna Beach, you know, hillside Oceanside, you know, just overlooking the ocean up on this beautiful bluff. Everybody who sees it is just amazed, wants to live there. Oh, I wish I had that house. Until about 2 weeks of rain straight washes away a soft foundation, and now that home has slid down the bluff, and it lies in rubble, and it's worthless. Jesus says to us today, your life is a lot like that. If you build it on the praise and approval of people who just can't help but think how good you are, I mean, if that's what you're building your relationship with God on, if you build it on being the smartest guy in the room, even the Bible answer man, right? If you build it on that, if you build it on your ability to win every argument, and everybody knows that, it's just the shifting sand of self. And it's going to let you down. Because what happens that when you're publicly shamed? What happens when illness strikes? What happens when your heart is broken? What happens when unemployment comes along and brings financial disaster? What then? Building on yourself won't cut it. And your life is going to be in rubble. And really what Jesus is getting at is this other storm that's coming. The storm of Judgment Day. The day when the Lord God will ask you, why should I let you into my heaven? If we point to ourselves, to our own goodness, well, then we are going to be so sorely disappointed, because that's not going to cut it either. So to each one of us right now, including the person in the pulpit, Jesus is saying this: cut it out. Knock it off. Stop building on something that cannot support you for eternity. Build on me. I am the rock. I'll hold you up. I'll hold you up through anything in this life. And I will hold you up for eternal life. This is what Jesus says to us today. And he does it by painting a picture of a wise person. He says, this is the wise person. They build their house on the rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, the winds blew and beat against that house, yet it did not fall because it had its foundation on the rock. You know what I love about that description is that Jesus nowhere says that when you build on the rock, you will be exempt from storms. He just says there may be lots of storm out there, but it ain't going to come in here. It won't come in the house. And the house might shake, but it isn't going to fall. And the reason for, and then everybody's going to be safe that's in the house. Why? Because there was a wise builder who built that house on a bedrock foundation. And of course, this is not just building advice. It goes way deeper than that. This is life advice. What kind of life are you building? Everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a person who has built their house on the rock. So building your life on the rock of Jesus, let's just consider that. It does mean hearing his word. It means hearing his promises. It means hearing his guidance for your life. But there's more to it than that. There's believing it. Believing that it is true for you so that you put it into practice. Believing that his promises are true for you. Believing that what he says, he means. He means it when he says, my sins have separated me from God, and that I am in desperate need of a Savior from sin. He means it when he says that there is forgiveness of sins in him, that he has cast them into the depths of the sea. He means that. He means it when he says that a joy-filled life is actually built on following his commands and doing his will. And that when we live according to his guidance, that's true joy. He means that when he says it. His commands are not burdensome. His commands are not out to suck the fun out of our life, but actually to give us joy in our life. And he means it when we're in our final hours. He means it when he says, the one who is connected to me through faith will live forever. Building your life on the rock means that you know that this is not kinda true. It's not like this might be true, but that it is true for you. And Jesus is gonna speak that truth in every season of your life, all the time, even, and I would say, especially the hard times, especially during the storms. And that truth kept coming back to me over the last couple weeks, especially as I listened to three African-American men discuss what they were feeling and how they were responding to George Floyd's murder. And how they felt about racial and social injustice in our country. All three men are members of our congregation. And while each of them was very real and very blunt about the problems we face in our country, because of systemic racism, all three of them kept coming back to the bedrock, the touchstone, the only hope for a solution. And that's the words of Jesus. Building your house on the rock. Seeing yourself and the person with whom you have a disagreement as both being creations of God. Both being made in the image of God. Finding your identity not in being smarter, not in being louder, not in being more clever, not in being more passionate, but finding your identity in belonging to Christ. And then, from there, working tirelessly toward what is right. not just who is right. And I was so thankful for that testimony from D'Angelo and Ron and Lewis. If you need evidence that we live in a world where the storms come up quickly and ferociously, 2020 is your year. And they come up so quickly and ferociously that you better believe your house is going to get shook. And we begin to wonder who we are. And the rock comes to us today and he says, I'll tell you whose you are. You belong to God through my work. You are his child. You are an heir of eternal life. And whose you are makes all the difference in who you are and how you talk to others and how you relate to others. If you have ever doubted the love of God in your life during the storm, listen to the rock today, because he's saying, I am your proof. I'm your proof that God loves you forever. I've been thinking a lot about the Apostle Paul lately, and my mind just recently turned to the fact that before he was Paul, he was Saul. He was Saul of Tarsus. He was an outwardly religious man who was building his life, building his pathway to God on being smarter and better and stronger and more clever and more sophisticated and more devout than any of his peers. In fact, he was pretty sure he was peerless. But one day, on the road to Damascus, he learned just exactly how flimsy that foundation was, because the Lord God just washed it all away. Many years later, after the Lord had allowed him to build his life on the rock of Jesus, Paul would write about all of that human accomplishment stuff that used to be his relationship with God, and how now he counted it as, Philippians chapter 3, garbage, rubbish, useless. And then he said, I just want to know Christ. I just want to be found in him. I just want to be wrapped in his righteousness. I just want to know the power of his resurrection. That's what I'm building on right now. So, friend, what are you building your life on? Build it on Jesus. Build it on what he has accomplished. That's a real life. That's a rich life. That's a life worth living. Now and forever. Amen. Let us pray. How firm a foundation, O saints of the Lord, is laid for our faith in God's excellent word. What more can he say than to us he has said, who unto the Savior for refuge have fled. Amen. Having heard the word of God, let's now confess our faith in God using the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became fully human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. In our prayers this morning, we ask the Lord's blessing, and we offer up a prayer of thanksgiving for Jessica and Alex Randazzo, who just found out that they will be having a baby, their first child, and so we ask for God's blessing upon them. We're going to pray for Samantha Evans and Brad Reinhardt, who were married yesterday right here at St. Marcus. We're praying for Holly Beckman and especially asking the Lord to hold her up during this time of particularly heavy burden in her life of cancer treatment. We'll pray for Gary Evans, whose father passed away this past week. Let us pray. We praise you, Lord God, for you have fearfully and wonderfully made a baby for Jessica and Alex, a little soul that they are so thankful for and so look forward to meeting. Continue to grant them the love and understanding to care for this dear child and to bring him or her up in your nurture and training. And Lord God, we praise you today for uniting Samantha and Brad in holy matrimony. Send your spirit into their marriage so that the love, their love for each other, grows each day, warmed by the love that you have shown them. Lord, be with Holly, with your healing hand and your encouraging spirit. Hold her hand by the promise of your presence. Uplift her heart by the power of your word. Work through the medical professionals in her life to do your work of restoring her. Work through her family of faith to do your work of reviving her spirit. Send your word of comfort and truth into the heart of Gary and his family as he mourns his father's passing. Remind him of your grace and faithfulness in these matters of life and death, and of your sure promise of everlasting life for the children of God. We know that our Redeemer lives. May this comfort live in the hearts of the Evans family. Lord, encourage within all of us a heartfelt desire to build our lives on your Son, Jesus Christ, on the certainty of his death and resurrection, the loving guidance of his word to us. Help us to see ourselves in each other, to find our value and our identity in Jesus. And as we do, lead us to reach out in reconciliation across all the chasms and divisions the devil wants to create. Use each one of us to embrace the ministry of reconciliation to which you have called us, to treasure all people as souls for which Christ shed his blood, to listen, to understand, not merely to respond. All these things we ask, Lord God, in Jesus' name, and in his name we now continue to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Our closing hymn, hymn number 293. With a believing heart, receive the blessing of the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with his favor and give you peace. Amen. We were so thankful that you were able to worship with us today. We wish you God's richest blessing in every way this week as you walk in the Word.